Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You know, the words of that song were familiar, weren't they?
Yes.
At least some of them were. They were taken from what chapter?
Psalm 91.
Psalm 91. Yes, it's a promise to us, isn't it? Can man be omnipotent is the title that I have today. And where does this come from? I was talking with a brother. Oh, it was several weeks ago, maybe a couple months ago or so. And he mentioned the phrase about man becoming omnipotent. And after he said it, both he and I thought about it. And I talked with him and sort of questioned whether it was valid. We both did. So I decided to do a study on this, and this is what I came up with. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians 1:18. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Tell of his power. Tell of his power to save. Tell of his power to sing of his love. Tell of his power to save all who come to him. Tell of his power to save every sinful soul who will cast himself upon Christ's merits. Tell of his power in the congregation of the saints. The everlasting hills tell of his power. Now, I'd like you to remember this reference here that I'm going to share. I'll be saying it several times, and by the end, hopefully, you will be able to say it back. As the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Whatever is to be done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. That's right. I'd like for the young people to take a piece of paper. And as I go through this, if they can write down the word power, the word omnipotence, and the forms of those words, whether it be power, omnipotence, almighty, those are all the same synonyms. And make a mark each time I say those words, and we'll see how many times that is. You know, there's power in nature, tremendous power in nature. How many have seen a tornado? One, two. It's very destructive. I haven't seen one in person, but we were living in Arkansas, and we went into town afterwards. We saw some of the destruction that took place. We didn't know what happened until we went in town. There's power in nature. Tornadoes, hurricanes. One of the strongest hurricanes, if not the strongest hurricane, was Patricia. 200 miles an hour winds. I can't imagine anything standing at 200 mile an hour winds. Devastating. And over the history, there's been earthquakes. Back in about the 600, somewhere in that vicinity, earthquakes over 8.5 on the Richter scale. They've been increasing over the years. In the last few years, as in last, 2010, 2011, 2012, each year there was one of those earthquakes, over 8.5. Nature tells of God's power. And people want power. How many places do you go where you see a billboard or a sign of a where people play games, and they have these names of their teams? There's like the Hornets, there's the Bears, the Wildcats, but everything that says that, you know, they're stronger than the other one. People desire power. Where did this come from? Let's look in Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, starting with verse 12. This is before the world was created. Isaiah 14, starting with verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. What is this speaking of?
Power.
Satan was not satisfied with the position that he had. He wanted something better. He looked to Christ, but he wasn't looking to Christ. He was looking past him, and he wanted his position. He wanted to be equal with God. He wanted to be above God, essentially. Satan determined to dethrone God. He wanted to be omnipotent. And Christ, when he came to this earth, what did the devil promise to Christ? Let's look in Luke. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verse 5, 6, and 7. And the devil, taking him up, which is Christ, up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for this is delivered unto me, to whomsoever I will, I give it. What did Satan offer Christ? Power. Did Christ already have power? Who had more power, Satan or Christ? How could Satan offer him something he didn't have then? Going back to the Garden of Eden, in Genesis 3, this is the beginning of the woes of this world. Genesis 3, verse 5. Again, Satan speaking to Eve from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, says, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes will be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Again, he was tempting man to become like God, not in the way that we are to become like God, because we are. We are to be like him in a certain way. But he was presenting the power that Adam and Eve could have. Satan thought that he would have human beings allies against heaven to dethrone the omnipotent one, and once more take his place in heaven. A clear conception of what God is and what he requires us to be will give us a humble views of ourselves. He who studies aright the sacred word will learn that human intellect is not omnipotent, that without the help which none but God can give, human strength and wisdom are but weakness and ignorance. There was a powerful explosion that killed an estimated 140,000 people and brought a country to its knees. When was that? Hiroshima. The year was 1945. The most powerful bomb ever dropped on a city exploded. It contained over 12,000 tons of TNT, the power of it, and was 2,000 times more powerful than any bomb ever dropped on a city. And the United States became the first and only nation to use atomic weaponry during wartime. This reminds me of a text in Revelation 13. You're familiar with this text. Revelation 13, verse 11 through 13. says, I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and spake as a dragon. Verse 12, and he exercised all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. I don't think this is the fulfillment of this prophecy. I think this is still going to be more dramatically fulfilled. But nonetheless, it is a fulfillment, as we see what the nation did. But why are we given power? What's power given to us for? Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Says, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which swear unto thy fathers, as it is this day. Some people look at the first part of that, and that's what they want. They want the wealth. But this isn't what this is given for. What is the power given for? It has the wealth involved in there, but what is that wealth? It's more than just financial wealth. It is a wealth of character, a wealth of our very being. And it says there that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto his fathers. In John. John 1st, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 12. John 1, 12. But as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become, what?
The sons of God.
The sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. What does God give us power for? Become the sons of God. It's not to destroy, as it was in Hiroshima and other wars of the nations. By obedience, we are given power to overcome as Christ overcame. By receiving him, you are given power to become the sons of God. But was redemption an afterthought? Why wasn't it?
For God so loved the world.
He knew before that it would happen. It was not an afterthought. He planned for it. The purpose of the plan of grace existed from all eternity. Before the foundation of the world, it was according to the determinate counsel of God that man should be created and endowed with power to do the divine will. The fall of man and all its consequences was not hidden from the omnipotent. Now there's an interesting combination that is expressed. And this is found, I believe it's found in Revelation 5. Both 5 and 6. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book, to loose the seven seals thereof. And behold, and I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain. You have two things here. One, you have a lion on the one hand, which is one of the most powerful beasts in nature. It's feared. And yet you have, on the other hand, a lamb. one of the most helpless, one that has to be cared for, one that gets lost easily, one that goes astray. You have this combination, and what is this referring to? This is referring to Christ, is it not? How can one have the power and the lack of which that Christ had? The lamb and the lion. Now, omnipotence is only mentioned once in the Bible. And that's in Revelation 19, verse 6. We won't turn there. That was our reference that we read at the beginning. But I'd like to look at the word omnipotent. What is the definition of omnipotent? All-powerful. Almighty. Invincible. Unstoppable. They're not as complete as all-powerful. But nonetheless, they give the idea of there's nothing above, nothing below them, or nothing above them, I should say. They are over everything. What does that describe? As we think of that word, those words, what does that describe? Does that not describe the God? Who is above that? There is nothing above that. The opposite of that is powerless, weak, impotent, feeble, powerless, ineffective, nerveless, helpless. All these things, what does that describe? Man. And yet you have that combination of the lamb, which is what, like, we are called sheep many times. You have that combination of the lamb, and you have the combination of the lion. The power and the weakness, all in one person. Christ was total human and total God. And he came to save us. What a stupendous thought, what unheard of condescension, what amazing love, that finite man may be allied to the omnipotent. To them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Beloved, now we are sons of God, the sons of God. Can any worldly honor equal this? Let's turn to 2 Corinthians 12, 9, briefly. 2 Corinthians 12, 9. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So the reference that I read earlier, the will of man, as the will of man cooperates with the will of God, what happens to it? It becomes omnipotent. Whatever is to be done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. I'd like to talk about a story that's found in the Bible in 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 14. You know, we've been discussing in the Sabbath school lesson about Abraham. Tremendous man of faith. And as we think of the various things that he went through to establish that faith, we can put ourselves in his shoes somewhere. Where are we in that? But the story I'd like to look at here first is of Jonathan and his armor bearer, found in 1 Samuel 14, verse 6, starting with verse 6. The surroundings of this is when the Philistines came to battle against the armies of Israel. And Saul had very, very few people, very few in his army. They had scattered. He had about 600 left. Tremendous army to face against him. And here they are, quivering in their shoes. And Jonathan does something. In verse 6 it says, "And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, 'Come, and let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few.'" Is that presumption? He was one man, two men, if you want to count his arm bearer. Against how many? Was he two men? He saw himself as more than two men. He knew that the host of heaven was behind him. And in their condition, it was hopeless. But yet he looked at the situation and said, "The Lord is stronger, and perhaps he will save." Was that a perhaps of a questioning, or perhaps a question of direction? Jonathan knew that the Lord could save, but whether he would use him to save is the question in his mind. So what happened to them? They went by the cliff. They hid themselves. And here this cliff was basically impassable, and the army, the Philistine army, was up on top. They didn't think anybody could climb that cliff, so they didn't really guard it very well. And so they came around this cliff, and then they showed themselves. What's it say here? In verse 9, "If they say unto us, 'Tarry until we come to you,' then we will stand still in our place and will not go up unto them." Have you ever found yourself in a place where you don't know what to do, and you pray to God, and you do anyway without his answer? What happens? It's a mess. Here, Jonathan did something. He said, "I'm going to stand here. If they say this, I'm going to stand here. I'm going to wait for God's answer." But, in verse 10, if they say thus, "Come up unto us, then we will go up, for the Lord hath delivered them into our hand, and this shall be a sign unto us." Are we willing and ready to wait for a sign? Many times, we face many different decisions. Some are simple. Which clothes shall I wear out of the closet? What shoes shall I put on? Some of us have the choice of which car shall I drive. And I remember my mom, when she was young, that did happen. My grandfather, they decided to drive a different car than they normally drove, which they had two cars, obviously. But it was a bigger, bulkier car. And on the way to church, they had an accident. But because it was a bigger car, it hit the tire. On these older cars, they had tires on the side. That's where they got hit, is where that tire was. I'm not sure it damaged the car, but they were safe because of the car they chose. So God directs us day by day, sometimes in a miraculous way, sometimes in an obvious way, sometimes not so obvious, and we don't find out until afterwards, and we may never find out. But here, Jonathan was asking for a sign, and God gave him a sign. What was the sign? If they said, "Come up." And then, in verse 11, "And both of them discovered themselves unto the garrison of the Philistines. And the Philistines said, 'Behold, the Hebrews come forth out of the holes where they had hid themselves.' And the men of the garrison answered Jonathan and his armor-bearer and said, 'Come up to us, and we will show you a thing.'" Wouldn't you like that solid answer? They knew what they could do. They knew God was leading them. They knew that they could go up there. So therefore, they hid themselves again. They didn't go obviously up to them. They were a little discreet in what they did. Sometimes we may run into a situation and think that the Lord is leading and we aren't careful at that. We need to be careful even in knowing the Lord's leading. So they got to the top. In verse 13, and Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. It's sort of an interesting picture here, because I don't see Jonathan killing the Philistines. I see his armor bearer killing the Philistines, because they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew afterwards, whether they did or not. But there was only about 20 there that were destroyed, that were killed at that time. But then something happened. What happened? An earthquake. Why was the earthquake? Was it because of a natural occurrence? Or were the armies of heaven joining Jonathan and his armor bearer? I believe that God was involved in that, very closely involved in that. And the earth shook, and it discomfited the whole Philistine army until they were destroying themselves. Then it was that Saul and his army sort of found out what was going on, and they took out after Jonathan's work and continued the work. God's work for our in our lives is marvelous, and we can look for Him to do mighty things when we have problems that we come across. One of the synonyms of omnipotence is almighty. And let's turn to Genesis chapter 17, verse 1. We've been studying about this more in our lesson, so you're familiar with the story. We actually haven't gotten to this part in the story too much, except a couple weeks ago, I believe. But in verse 1, and then Abraham... And when Abraham was 90 years old, 17, verse 1. And when Abraham was 90 years old and 9, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. Now, when did this take place in Abraham's life? This was still when he was Abram. This was before he was Abraham, or actually it was at this time that he was called Abraham. This is also at the time when Sarai was renamed Sarah. This was after what we talked about in our lesson today, after Hagar, after he had deceived the king of Egypt, after Lot had been separated and gone into Sodom. But before Sodom was destroyed. Be thou perfect. God will accept only those who are determined to aim high. He places every human agent under obligation to do his best. Moral perfection is required of all. What does that say? Moral perfection is required by all. Never should we lower the standard of righteousness in order to accommodate inherited or cultivated tendencies. We need to understand that imperfection of character is sin. Imperfection of character is sin. Sometimes we think that what we do is sin, but if we have a trait in our character that is imperfect, that is sin. All righteous attributes of character dwell in God as a perfect, harmonious whole, and everyone who receives Christ as a personal Savior is privileged to possess these attributes. That's the power of God in our lives. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And in Matthew 5:48, what does it say? Be therefore perfect. Who is it comparing it to? As your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. We are to be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. How can we do this? In James 1:4, what does that verse chapter say? In verse. James 1:4. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. What did we see about the patience of Abraham? As he took Hagar, he was not patient. He did not realize the faith that it required, but he lacked the faith, and he was not patient. Let patience have its perfect work. Those who accept Satan's reasoning are terribly deceived. They accept a position which has no true foundation. God is unchangeable. He is satisfied with nothing short of perfect obedience. Perfection is the only title which will gain admittance to heaven. The law is the standard of character. As the will of man, what's the rest of it? As the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Whatever is to be done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. Omnipotence. Is omnipotence in and of ourselves?
No.
No. We can never be omnipotent in and of ourselves. But it's as we put our will on the side of God, as we cooperate with the will of God, then our will becomes omnipotent and he gives us the power to overcome. Let's look in Matthew 28. Matthew 28, verse 18. And Jesus came, starting with verse 18, and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Now, what did Christ receive that power for? He didn't just keep it, he gave it. It says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Christ was given power that he might give us power. The promise given by Christ, Jesus to his disciples was for the benefit of all who should comply with the conditions of Christ to the end of time. God is omnipotent, and man may be strong to accomplish his purpose while he has the promise of divine help in every emergency. God's power is hidden from the unbelieving. His ways and purposes are not understood by them. The world knoweth him not, but mighty victories are gained through the prayers of the obedient children of God, presented in the name of Jesus. The secret of success of the people of God is connection with him in prayer. And what's the other requirement? And humble obedience of his requirements. Jesus urged upon his disciples the necessity of obeying the commandments he had given them if they would abide in his love. The comfort promised to his followers was on this condition. it's interesting to think about the various things in nature. When this world was created, did creation fall? Man fell. Creation didn't fall, although it suffered the consequences of the fall. The earth is the Lord's. Here we may be seen in nature, animate and inanimate, obeys his will. God created man a superior being. He alone is formed in the image of God and is capable of partaking of the divine nature, of cooperating with his creator and executing his plans. And he alone is found at war with God's purposes. It's a shame. The highest being on this earth is alone against God. With the majesty of the omnipotent King, our Savior unites the gentleness and tenderness of a shepherd. His power is absolute. That's omnipotence, isn't it? His power is absolute. The heart of man is only, let me start over, the heart of man only is able to withstand his working. It's interesting that God allows that to take place. The heart of man only is able to withstand his working. But that's the love that he has for us, because he allows for us to make that choice, to take his power or not, to take his character or not. Yet God's purposes cannot be thwarted. A noble character is earned by individual effort through the merits and grace of Christ. God gives the talents, the powers of the mind. We form the character. We have our part to play. We have talents that God has given us, but that's not where it's left. As we work with him, as we unite our efforts with him, we form the character. It is formed by hard, stern battles with self. Conflict after conflict must be waged against hereditary tendencies. We shall have to criticize ourselves closely and allow not one unfavorable trait to remain uncorrected. How many of us have no bad tendencies in our lives? Each of us have cultivated and inherited tendencies to evil. And yet each of us is different. What is a temptation for one, another is not a temptation at all. We need to help each other in those areas as well. Let no one say, I cannot remedy my defects of character. If you come to this decision, you will certainly fail of obtaining everlasting life. The impossibility lies in your own will. If you will not, then you cannot overcome. So where does it lie? In our will. As the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Whatever is done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. Link up with the one that is perfect and who has power to sanctify you and give you fitness to receive the life that measures with the life of God. That in itself is another statement that, to me, is beyond my comprehension. How can our lives measure with the life of God? How can we have the omnipotence, all-powerful, in our lives? God is so gracious to give those things to us. We are nearing the close of this earth's history, and we soon will stand before the throne of God. Our opportunities to work will be past. With the help of God, every true believer can see where there is work to be done. As we look around us, do we see a need? Do we see those in need? Do we see those suffering? Watch for opportunities to speak a word in season to them. Do not wait for introduction. Many times when we're out in public, we see people and we say, I don't know them. We're not to wait for introduction. If we see a need, we can help that need. Watch for opportunities to speak a word in season. Do not wait for an introduction or until you become acquainted with them before you seek to save the perishing souls around you. If you will go to work in earnest, ways will be opened before you for the accomplishment of this work. Let's turn to Jude, chapter 23. Verse 23 as well. Let's turn to Jude 23. You know, it's most of them have chapters, so. Jude 23. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. What was it to Christ when he came to this earth? He was pure. He was completely holy. His garments were unspotted. But yet he came to our earth, pulled us out of the fire. But I'd like to leave this with you. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty and dominion and power both now and ever. Amen.